let me go ahead and get us started in two series that we've combined here. If I'm saying it right, we have the Alumni All-Star Series. Of course, we have an alumnus with us here today. Also, this is the Hero Healer Series. The idea behind the Hero Healer Series is we want to put in front of you individuals whose lives can be an inspiration, can remind you of why you got into medicine in the first place, and who've committed themselves to taking care of the underserved. And so so this day, we're blessed to have with us Dr. Rudy Jimenez, graduated from KCOM in 1990, came here from Southern California, and I was waiting for Lori to see if Lori comes in the door here. We haven't seen her yet, Lori, but Haxton, when she gets here, okay, we can talk a little bit more about that. So Rudy went into private practice for a very short period of time and decided this wasn't medicine that he really wanted. Rudy, are you telling this story? Oh, okay. I'm going to stop now so I don't interrupt the story that he's going to tell you guys here. Let's welcome Rudy Jimenez.
Thank you, Gary. Can you hear me? Okay. Everybody can hear me? So my presentation today is mainly going to be based around working for a community health center. But before I do that, I want to start off with a little story. And that story has to do with one of my first meetings with Dr. Gary Cloud. This was back in around 1996. I had just become medical director for the community health center that I had started 2 years earlier working for. And I started attending the association meetings in Arizona. There was the Arizona Association of Community Health Centers, where all the executive directors, the medical directors attended these monthly meetings. And Gary was part of that association. So keep in mind, I had just started. Okay, so I really didn't know very many people. At one of the breaks, I go to the bathroom and I'm minding my own business, doing my thing. Next to me comes up Dr. Cloud. I don't know him, right? And all of a sudden he starts talking to me. Keep in mind, this is not a normal social setting. So the things going through my mind are, you know, it's going crazy. But he starts talking to me and he says, "So aren't you Dr. Jimenez? Aren't you the new medical director for Sun Life?" And I said, yeah, you know, yeah, should I even be talking to him? And he goes, "You know, have you ever thought about taking medical students in your clinic? You guys are big enough and busy enough, it'd be a good thing." So here I am, not knowing how to answer, but you know, I have known Dr. Cloud for 21 years now. And I know now there's a method to his madness. Because at that point, I would have agreed to anything just for him to leave me alone and I can rejoin the group, right? But anyways, that was my first introduction to Dr. Cloud. So my goal today is to talk about what a community health center is. For the students that are out there, can you show me by raising your hand if you know what a community health center is? Yeah, okay. So actually, there's quite a few of you that know what a community health center is. And that's great, because I can tell you when I was in your shoes, sitting in this exact same lecture hall, I had no clue of what a community health center was. So that is one of my goals for the rest of you, to know what a community health center is. I want to share some of my personal experiences. Some of the benefits that there are working for a community health center, and hopefully inspire one, two, maybe more of you to work at a community health center once you're done. Okay? So let me tell you a little bit about myself first. I was born in Mexico City, and my father, before he got married, he had been coming over to the United States and used to work as a contracted worker. In the 50s, they would have contracted workers that would come up to the States, work in the fields seasonally, and they go back to Mexico. That's what my father did. He then met my mom, they got married, and I was born, and he got his green card. So now he kept doing that. He kept coming to the United States, work seasonally in the fields, go back, spend, you know, 4 or 6 months with us, and then he would come back. After a while, that got old, and he started working on getting my mother and I a green card, which we did. So when I was 6 years old, we moved to Southern California for a better life. Growing up in Southern California, I was the oldest. When my parents moved to Southern California, my three brothers were born and eventually my sister, which, by the way, there's 22 years difference between myself being the oldest and my sister, but they wanted that girl, you know, and they kept trying and they finally got their girl. So being the oldest in a non-English, with non-English speaking parents, I was the one that was always used, or not used, but I was brought along when my family members were sick. And I used to interpret. I was the official interpreter. And I think that is why I very early wanted to become a doctor, because I saw what a great job, profession, being a doctor, healing people. But also I saw the need of having Spanish-speaking physicians. So I very early knew that I wanted to become a doctor. So this is in the 70s, growing up in the 70s. In California, I had no clue what a DO was. Osteopathy, you know, all the doctors that we went to see had the initials MD after them. So what's an osteopath? I had no clue. And the reason for that is, keep in mind that up to 1961, California had the largest number of practicing physicians in the state compared to any other state. Up to 1961, California had the most practicing DOs. They were providing care for an estimated 15% of California's population. As a matter of fact, the longest continuously running medical school in the state of California was a DO school that had been, one of the founders was a Kirksville graduate. And are any of you from California, Southern California? Well, UC Irvine has a medical school, and UC Irvine actually took over that osteopathic school, which, again, growing up in Southern California, I knew UC Irvine had a medical school, but I never knew that the origins had been as an osteopathic school. And that's actually a picture of the very first, the Pacific Sanitarium and School of Osteopathy chartered in Anaheim, California. They actually took over an old hotel. So again, a historical fact. So why is this? Why was it that I didn't know what an osteopath was? And that's because back in 1962, Proposition 22 passed. And Proposition 22 was actually an amendment to unify the two professions, the DO profession and the MD profession. But what it really did, it took away the power of the osteopathic board of examiners, took away their power and pretty much made them go away. And any practicing DO that wanted to continue practicing in the state converted their initials from DO to an MD degree. Just like that, overnight. Overnight, the osteopathic profession goes away. So fortunately, in 1974, the Supreme Court overturns Proposition 22. California's Osteopathic Medical Licensing Board is reinstated. DO degrees come back. By the way, that osteopathic medical school that I talked about that had been in existence in 1962, once that proposition went in effect, they stopped issuing DO degrees. Now they were issuing MD degrees. So 1974, Supreme Court overturns it. The return of the DO degrees come, you know, they're back. Unfortunately, some of those physicians that had been, that had previously been DOs, they just didn't want to bother. They just kept the MD degree. So that's why, growing up in the 70s, I had no clue what a DO was. So now it's 1980s, and I'm doing my undergraduate. Chapman, at that time, was Chapman College. It is now Chapman University, but it's a small liberal arts school in the city of Orange, in right next to Anaheim. So if you've been to Disneyland, we were just a 15-minute drive from Disneyland. So I'm attending, I'm in probably my third year of undergraduate, and the admissions director for the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific, the new medical school in Pomona, came over to the campus, talked about the program, and invited us to attend an open house that they were going to have a Saturday. That was the next Saturday or the following Saturday. So I and a couple of my classmates attended that orientation on that Saturday, and guess what? That was my first exposure to osteopathy. And after, by the end of the day, I knew that I did not want to be an MD. I wanted to become a DO. Why is that? I truly felt after that experience that Saturday that I would personally have more to offer my patients. Why do I say that? Well, keep in mind, I grew up in the Hispanic culture, and I saw many of my relatives, when they were sick, would they go see an MD right at the beginning? No. They would search out and seek out curanderos or sobadores. So as a physician, seeing what the osteopaths did, I felt that I would have more to offer. So what is a curandero or a curandera? They're folk healers who use folk remedies, magic, spiritualism to treat illness. A sobador is a healer who works on the material level and specializes in the treatment of tense muscles, sprains, many times doing manipulation similar to what we do. So seeing that, I knew, I don't want to be an MD. I want to have more to offer to my patients, because I firsthand had seen how this was sought out by family members. Hey, do you know of a sobador that can fix me with my leg problem or my arm? You know, they would seek out these people. So now it's time to apply, and there's three schools that I knew I wanted to apply to. Kirksville was one of them, and the reason I wanted to apply to Kirksville, because the summer of 1985, I attended a summer program. It was an 8-week program at the osteopathic school in Fort Worth, Texas. And it was for students that were like myself, minority students, to give them an exposure to the osteopathic profession, have them go through this 8-week program where we would attend classes very similar to what we would expect to see in a medical program. We were exposed to manipulation. And while I was there, the admissions director for Kirksville attended and talked about the school. And the way she talked about the school really made me want to apply. Lori, is that Lori? That's Lori. Do you remember 1985 going to Fort Worth, Texas? Anyway, because she was there, she opened my eyes to Kirksville, and I knew, yeah, that's the school I want to apply to. So I ended up applying to three, Des Moines, the school in Pomona, just because I was there in California, and Kirksville. My first interview was in Pomona. I went to the interview. I left the interview thinking, wow, do I really want to come here? I mean, it was like just not a good feeling. My next interview is Kirksville. I fly out. I attend my interview here. I'm paired up to meet with some of the students, and they show me around, and the whole feeling was like they really wanted me. You know, it was so different than what I had experienced in Pomona that I left here with my fingers crossed. Oh, please, please. 1 week later, I get my admissions letter. So now, keep in mind, I have another interview to go to in Des Moines, but it's like, I don't need to go to another school and interview. Kirksville felt great, felt perfect. I want to go to Kirksville. So I called Pomona and thanked them, but said, please take me off the waiting list. I called Des Moines and thanked them and said, I won't be attending the interview. This was it. So for me, this was the best decision I have made, coming to Kirksville. So if you're trying to figure out where I am or which one of those is me, see this guy here? Kind of looks like Tony Orlando, right there with the mustache. Well, that's me. yeah, funny what you can get on off the internet now, huh? So I graduated in 1990, and now I'm in Tucson, Arizona, and now I decide, initially when I enrolled here, I thought I was going to become a pediatrician. But once I got out into my student rotations, man, I liked everything. I liked the exposure. I liked seeing everything. So I did not want to limit myself to seeing the same thing over and over. I wanted to see it all. So family practice, I thought, was gonna be ideal. So I attended, I got into the family practice residency program at Tucson General Hospital. It was an osteopathic residency program. So now it's 1993. I'm living the life, right? 1993, I graduated from medical school. I finished my residency program. Now I'm out practicing, and I join private practice. Well, guess what? 10 months later, I'm going, what did I do? I made the wrong career move. I'm not enjoying medicine. I'm walking out of the exam rooms thinking, how did I help this patient? This is, you know, this is not fulfilling. This is not what I went to medical school. This is not what I thought it was going to be. It was terrible. I mean, just a terrible feeling. Now, what am I going to do? Because I have a huge school debt. For me, at that time, I know it's more now, but for me at that time, it's $180,000 of school debt. How am I going to pay that off? If I leave medicine, where can I make enough money to do this? So by this time, my first daughter was born during my last year of my residency program. My second daughter is now born, my first year out. You know, I used to laugh about the fact that my diploma, which hung in the wall of this house, I was paying. My loan repayment was twice what my mortgage payment was. So here I'm paying more for this diploma hanging in this wall, but I'm paying twice that each month to repay it back. I have children, you know, that I have to provide for. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? I'm not enjoying this. This is not what I thought it was going to be, what it was going to be like. Well, I figured I have to get rid of this huge debt. If I even am gonna look at another career option, I can't have this debt hanging over me. So, and the reason I ask how many of you are familiar with community health centers is because, you know, I hadn't been when I was a student. But once I got out and I had this debt, I realized that there was such a thing as the National Health Loan Repayment Program. I'm sure you all know of it, have heard, yes? Raise your hands, yes? Good. So at that time, I knew that for the first year, you got $25,000 for that year. The second year, you got another $25,000. And this is all money that you get in a lump sum. And I used to just turn it around and pay it to the bank. Boom, $25,000, gone. The third year, $35,000. Fourth year, $35,000. So for 4 years, I can get my debt down from 180 to 120. In 4 years, I could do that. So that's what I did. I joined a community health center just north of Tucson. And here's an old picture I found, a headline. At that time, it was called West Pinnell Family Health Center. It is now called Sunlight Family Health Center. But at that time, in 1994, it was West Pinnell Family Health Center. So let me tell you a little bit about this building. The building we were in was over 20 years old. And the reason it existed was because it originally was constructed for the purpose of providing training to migrant workers. It was a way of training the migrant workers to try to get them out of the fields, give them other opportunities. Well, that program then began having a doctor come to treat the students and their families one day a week turned to 2 days a week, then 3 days a week, and eventually every day of the week. Well, the funding, unfortunately, the funding for that program went away. But the clinic continued, and eventually it became a federally qualified health center. So now here we are seeing patients in this not ideal building, but we're doing it. About a couple times a month, the sewer system, something would happen and this smell would permeate the whole building. So we would open doors, we would open windows, we would get fans blowing to get that smell out. At least once a week, the AC would go out. And this is Arizona, you know, where you get, you know, 109 degree temperature is not unusual. So it was fine at 8 o'clock in the morning when we started the day, you know, it was fine. We would start seeing patients, but then the AC would go out. And then by noon, the executive director would come around and say, all right, guys, we're canceling all the appointments this afternoon. We're sending everybody home because they won't be able to fix the AC unit until this afternoon, but come back tomorrow. Okay, great. So here, remember now, I went from working in a pretty plush private practice, you know, a nice facility, patients that were well-to-do, you know, to all of a sudden, here I am working for a community health center in not the ideal setting, you know, patients that would come in the room, maybe weren't the cleanest, maybe they didn't smell the best. But guess what? You would think, having come from that private practice to this setting, that if I didn't like medicine then, now I would truly be miserable. Guess what? It wasn't true. This is what I was meant to do. This, because now, even though it wasn't the ideal practice setting, I was helping patients that truly needed help. That truly, I mean, patients that would wait until the very last minute to come in and get treatment. I tell people when I first started there, you know, we were not only seeing the patients in the clinic, but we were rounding in the hospital too. So the patients that we would admit directly from the clinic to the hospital. I always say seven of those 10 admissions were due to complications from diabetes because they weren't getting the care they needed on a day-to-day basis to keep themselves from getting a bad cellulitis, a bad infection, you know, that, oh my God, we need to get you in, we need to start IV antibiotics, we need to try to save your foot, right? So the other thing too is when I first started working at this health center, one of the things that every new patient I would see, their first question was, well, how long are you going to be here? You know, initially it would take me by surprise, but then I eventually found out why they were asking that. And that's because at that time, a clinic like that had the reputation of having doctors come in, work for 2 years, get loan repayment. After 2 years, they're gone. And that's what unfortunately what the patients were used to. So again, you know, being asked that every time, it's like, no, I'd like to stay here as long as the clinic would have me. So now, 2 years later, I'm still working at this health center and I'm happy. I mean, how much better can things get, right? Well, at that time, our medical director could no longer be our medical director. So our executive director is like, hey, which of you doctors want to be our medical director? Well, guess what? Nobody raised their hand. Nobody wanted to be the medical director. And being the newest doctor there, they said, hey, Rudy, you do it. You become the medical director. Not knowing any better, I said, okay, I'll become the medical director. So now I'm seeing patients 5 days a week in the clinic, plus now I have the added administrative responsibilities, you know, which mainly consisted of creating schedules, doctor schedules, writing policies and procedures, and making sure that the clinic was there and we were taking care of those patients that needed to be taken care of. So part of my duty also was to recruit doctors and work on remembering what my patients had always asked, and their expectation was doctors are only here for 2 years, to try to retain those doctors because I didn't want a revolving door. So as a medical director, you know, I knew I wanted to become a doctor, as a doctor, I did it because I wanted to help patients. I wanted to help people. So as a doctor, you help patients one-on-one in the exam room. I walk out thinking, yeah, I really helped somebody. Well, as a medical director, I soon found out that as a medical director, you can do more and help not just one patient, but you can help communities, whole communities, by either opening up new clinics, new clinical sites, bringing healthcare to rural areas that didn't have healthcare before, improving your facilities. So now 5 years later, and I've paid off. When I started the loan repayment program, the program was only a 4-year program. Lucky for me, on my last year of the program, they expanded it to a 5th year. And I was encouraged to apply. So I applied for the 5th year and I was awarded the 5th year. So the $120,000 that I thought I was going to get through the loan repayment program turned into $155,000. How great is that, right? Not only that, but because I had continued to make payments throughout that whole time, by my 5th year of practice, I was able to completely pay off my student loan. 5 years later, when initially I was looking at, it was going to take me 25 years to pay off my loan. 5 years later, how much better can it be? Not only that, I'm truly, truly enjoying what I'm doing. So, 2 years go by, you know, 5 years go by, now 9 years, and I've been the medical director for this organization for the last seven. The first 2 years, remember, I worked as just a physician. The last seven of those years, I am now the medical director, and had been working on improving, you know, recruiting doctors that didn't see us as a revolving door, but saw us as a career. And the way I did that was, you know, we worked on better incentives for the doctors. I, even though I was the medical director, I never stopped seeing patients. So I knew what they were going through. And our doctors knew that I was never going to ask of them to do something that I myself wasn't willing to do. So I always say, you know, I led by example. You know, I would do things and then ask them to do. Well, having, you know, when they see me do it, yeah, are they going to balk and say, no, that's too much, or no, that's too hard? No, you know, they themselves would do it. So now, 9 years later, three of our 10 hospital admissions are now due to complications, because now we're more accessible. We're taking care of those patients before they're really sick and they're really bad, in need of hospitalization. We now have providers, doctors, that have been working for the organization for 5 years or more. And patients were truly appreciative. I mean, you know, many of them would come and offer me little gifts. And for me, it was hard to accept those gifts. But I knew that if I didn't accept them, it was an insult. So I would graciously accept those gifts, knowing that many of these patients didn't have the things that I took for granted. Running water in their home, hot water to take a hot bath with, heat during the winter months, or even AC, you know, in the summer, AC, you know. So all these things that I took for granted, I knew that they didn't have. Reliable transportation, you know, that was another issue. One day my college roommate came to visit me, and let me tell you, he's doing really well. He's a lawyer. He's practicing in Los Angeles, and he came to my office and saw the little gifts that I had been receiving from patients. And he said, "Wow, Rudy," he goes, "you know, I have clients that give me bottles of liquor that are hundreds of dollars. You know, they're worth hundreds of dollars. I even had a client that gave me a brand new BMW, but nothing compares to the sentiment of the gifts that you've received." You know, how true is that? Because to me, that has meant more than anything. So now I'm going to lighten it up a little bit, and I'm going to talk about some of my personal experiences. Some of these experiences that I feel that I've experienced being a doctor, and I've used these experiences to help me grow and to become a better physician. So I told you my first daughter was born during my residency. So when it came time to the delivery, I got to deliver her. It was in a hospital setting. It wasn't at home. You know, we were in the hospital, but the OB who I had worked with was like, "Get in there, Rudy. You're going to deliver her." How great. You know, what a great experience to say you truly brought your child into the world, right? So that was the experience with my first daughter. My second daughter, however, was a little bit different. And the cartoon you see here, this was not my experience, and I'm going to go and get into it right now. So now, I told you my second daughter was born once I finished my residency program. So it's the morning of my wife's induction. She was a scheduled induction. That morning, my back went out, and I could barely walk. I mean, I'm just like, it was so bad that we drove to the hospital, but my wife had to drive herself as I sat in the passenger seat. We got to the hospital, and this is the hospital that I had worked at. We get out, you know, I'm barely walking, you know, I'm all crooked and I'm barely walking. The nurses roll out a wheelchair and they offer it to me instead of my wife, right? It's like, wait, no, she's a patient. So they finally get her into the room. They set her up and they start the induction. 3 hours later, the OB comes in to check on my wife. And he says, still has a ways to go. I'm going to be around, page me if you need me. Fine, no problems. Remember, I could barely move. I'm not being much help to my wife. I'm just sitting there in pain, right? Trying to find a comfortable position. But 45 minutes after the OB left, my wife is like, I have to push. The nurse checks her and says, oh my God, the baby's coming. So she starts getting the bed ready as they're paging the OB. And my wife is like, I have to push. Seeing that the OB was not coming, the nurse looks at me, hands me some gloves and a gown. So what do I do? I put on the gown, I put on the gloves, and I get there. So my wife is, she can't help it. She's pushing, right? So she's pushing and out comes the baby's head. Great, right? It's a great thing when you see the baby's head. But then I saw that the cord, that's why I say my experience wasn't what this is, because I saw the cord was wrapped around her neck. It's like, you know, and then I look at the nurse, and this is something you never want to see as a physician. When you look at a nurse, you never want to have her look at you like this. You know, you never want to see that look in her face. And that's the look that the nurse gave me. What do we do? So I tell my wife, don't push. And my whole reason for that was to have her not push, to relax enough so I can get release the tension and take the cord. But as I tell my wife, don't push, she yells back at me, don't tell me not to push. Oh my God, what am I going to do now? She's not going to cooperate. What do I do now? So I ask the nurse for some scissors because I'm just going to cut the cord right there. You know, because we can't relieve that. But right at that moment, my wife relaxed enough to relieve the tension, and I was able to pull the cord off, and the delivery went fine, right? Here's the baby, healthy. But I have to tell you that for 45 minutes after that, I was shaking. I mean, I had been in deliveries. I had delivered babies. I had experienced other babies with nuchal cords, and you know, not a problem. We deliver the baby; it was fine. We go on our way. But for me, that experience, really thinking of all the possibilities and all that could have gone wrong, I was shaking. I couldn't stop shaking for 45 minutes. But guess what? Remember how bad my back had been? All of a sudden, my back is great. Man, that adrenaline, let me tell you, that adrenaline is great drug. So another experience I want to talk to you about is, my oldest daughter is 18 months old, and I'm in the backyard with her, and we're planting some strawberries. It's a Sunday morning. We're out there planting strawberries, and over the wall pops up ahead and says, I'm sorry to bother you, but I know you're a doctor and I live right down the street and my neighbor is in a lot of pain. Would you mind coming and taking a look at her? And I said, yeah, let me go in, wash my hands, I'll be right out. I go in, I tell my wife, hey, you wanna come with me? Because I wanted to make sure I had a chaperone, right? There's a neighbor, she's in pain, let's go see what's going on. Wash my hands, got my stethoscope, we went and found her in the kitchen floor, in pain, just agony, just miserable. So I go through, I start asking her some questions, trying to get a differential, you know, of what's going on. I finally decide that she's passing a kidney stone. So my wife and I, the neighbor took her kids, said, you know what, I'll watch her kids, I'll have them with me. You take her to the emergency room. So my wife and I put her in our car and we drive her to the emergency room. Now I have to tell you that I had worked in that emergency room at the pediatric after hours clinic as a resident. So I was very familiar with the staff, the ER staff, the ER doctors. So when we pulled into the ER, my wife said, "You take her in," because she knew I knew the staff. "You take her in while I go park the car." Great. The staff came out, got a wheelchair. We wheeled her in. They're asking me what's going on. And I'm telling them, I think she's passing a kidney stone. So let's set her up. So as they're getting her ready for the doctor to come in, the neighbor is just squeezing my hand. She's just in pain. She's in agony, right? And she's pleading with me, "Please, please help me, help me." But remember, I'm not the doctor. I'm just the neighbor that brought her in. But here she is in agony, pleading with me, "Please help me." So what do I do? I say, "Okay, I'll be right back. Let me see if I can get help." So I go out and I ask the nurses, "Who's the ER doctor on?" And they tell me the name. And I'm going, no. I'm thinking, my neighbor's not going to get the help, you know, anything for pain. So anyway, I say, "Well, I have to try because I don't want to go back into that room and face her, right?" So I go and I find the doctor. And let me tell you, she was not known for being the most compassionate, but I had to try. So I say, "Hey, Dr. So-and-so, you know, I brought my neighbor in and she's really in a lot of pain and I think she's passing a kidney stone. Can you come and give her something for pain?" She barely looked up from what she was doing and she said, "I'll get to her when I'm done with this discharge." Great. Just what I expected, right? So now I'm thinking to myself, how am I going to go back and face my neighbor? You know, she's in pain. So I turn around and I start slowly walking back. And right then I hear somebody call out my name, "Rudy." And I turn around and there was Dr. Winter, who had been an ER doctor who I had worked with as a medical student. So he really knew me and I knew him. And I look at him and I say, are you working today?" And he goes, "Yeah, I'm just coming on shift." I say, "Oh," and I tell him, "I have a neighbor, I brought her in. I think she's passing a kidney stone. She's in a lot of pain. Can you come with me and give her something for pain?" "Yeah, let's go." So he comes in with me and evaluates her and he agrees, you know, so they start the workup and he orders pain medication for her. But you know what? For me, that experience was a true eye opener. That many times as physicians, we get out and we get too busy or too caught up and not realize that, you know, the family members that go in with these sick patients, they feel helpless. I mean, how terrible to be there, see somebody you love and you can't do anything about them. So from that point on, I told myself, not only am I going to do the best I can for my patients, but I'm also going to be there for the patients' families. So the last and final experience I want to tell you about is one day, and that this has to do with cause and effect, right? Because I realized that what patients, family members see is not always true. So one day I'm a resident and I'm working in the emergency room and in through the emergency doors, you know, running in is a man carrying his wife. And the wife is alert, but she's very shaky. So we put her on a gurney and we ask, "What's going on? What happened?" And the husband explains to us that the wife just tried to overdose by taking a whole bottle of theophylline. So we get the IV going and now we're putting an NG tube in because we're gonna need to pump her stomach and, you know, get her taken care of. But right there and then she started seizing. And seizing uncontrollably. So we're giving her IV medications to stop the seizing. The neurologist is there with us. And after seeing that this seizing is not stopping, we called anesthesia down, we intubated her, and we basically paralyzed her. Took her to the ICU, stabilized her, and treated her. And she did fine. But what was an eye-opener for me at that time was hearing the comments from the family, from the husband, when the other family members came by saying, You know, she was fine when I brought her in, but they tried to put that NG tube down and she started seizing because of that. Cause and effect, right? What they see is not always the reality. And under the best of conditions, somebody taking theophylline, that's a medication we monitor closely. We're doing blood levels because even under the best conditions, side effect of that could be seizures. But you overdose on it, now you have uncontrolled seizures, right? We had to paralyze her just to get this seizing stopped. So now the real reason why I'm here is because I would like for you to understand the purpose and the reasons why federally qualified health centers exist. I want you to know the benefits there are for working in a community health center. See, for me, you know, working at a community health center, I started out as a doctor, but 2 years later, now I'm the medical director, the opportunities that there are there for you. And hopefully when you leave here, this presentation, you'll have this in the back of your minds and maybe look into working for a community health center. So let me tell you a little bit of community health centers. They have been in existence since the first two community health centers came to be in 1965. The community health centers have grown since. Community health centers are not-for-profit organizations. They are community directed, or basically, we have a board of directors that I have to report to, and I meet with them once a month. And I tell them, you know, how things are going. They are there not to run the organization, but they are there to help govern. They are there to give us direction. They are there to make sure that we are complying with the requirements of the federal government. Community health centers are located in high need areas. We're open to all residents. So we don't just stick to one group. We're open to all. Each community health center tailors their services based on the needs of the community. We offer comprehensive primary care services. I like to think that we provide high quality care. I mean, I know that's my goal. We provide affordable, cost-effective care, and we are mission-driven. In the United States, the numbers from last year showed that there are over 1,400 community health centers throughout the country with over 9,800 delivery sites. 55% of them are located in rural areas. Last year, they served over 25 million patients. 300,000 were veterans, 1.2 million were homeless. 900,000 were migrant farm workers, and they had over 100 million office visits. They also employ a little over 190,000 people throughout the country. So now I'm going to talk about my health center. This is a picture of our health center. Far cry from when I started, right? This is like, I mean, the building, I feel truly fortunate to work in a facility like this. But, you know, this is just because our patients don't have money or can't afford healthcare, that doesn't mean they have to get their care in a place that's 30 years old or whatever. You know, we want to provide the best care we can to all in the same places. So this is our main clinic in Green Valley. Our organization has been a federally qualified health center since 1984. So we have existed since then. Last year, our numbers, we had 17,378 enrolled patients. We provided 46,140 medical visits, 4,279 pediatric dental visits. We have 9 clinical sites, and we're getting ready to build and open a 10th clinical site later this year. We're very excited about that. And we employ a little over 140 employees in our health centers. I'm going to show you some of the pictures of our clinics. So when I started in 2007, we only had three main clinical sites. We had the Aravaca Clinic. By the way, see this fence? When I first started, this is probably our most rural clinic. So see this fence? When I was looking at old pictures of this clinic, there was a chain link fence here. And one of the employees said, "Do you know why that fence exists?" And coming from California, I said, "Yeah, to keep people out for security." She said, "No, to keep the cows out." Keep the cows out? I thought she was joking. She said, "No, seriously, it was to keep the cows out." And that's true. There's a story really quick I'm going to tell you. Our doctor that has been working for the organization for 21 years, 22 years maybe by now, and initially he was the medical director, but he just, his heart is providing care to the rural clinics. He just wanted to stop being the medical director, and he's actually the one that called me and said, "Hey, you want to come and be the medical director over here?" But anyways, he was working late one day, and the rest of the staff left, and they kept the gates open, and a cow came in. Well, a neighbor, being neighborly, he wanted to help him out and wanted to get the cow to leave. Well, this cow had horns, and as the neighbor went to grab it, the cow hit him underneath the neck, and just, you can imagine, this close to hitting the carotid, but didn't. But now he's bleeding. He's trying to help Dr. Smith. So now Dr. Smith is at 6:30 stitching him up, right? At the end of the day, what a way to close the day. But anyway, just to give you an idea, rural medicine. This is our Three Points Clinic, again, in a rural area. Our clinic, the main clinic when I started in 2007 was this one. And then since then, we added a pediatric clinic. We've added a clinic in Sahuarita, a clinic in Vail, a clinic in Amado, another clinic on the hospital campus, a new hospital that was built in Green Valley. We're now there. So we have a total of 9 clinical sites. And as I mentioned, we're getting ready to open a 10th clinical site. We have 2 dental RVs, just like that. And these dental RVs go out to the schools. They park at the school and they can treat children right there and then. We have transportation vans. Why? Because many of our patients are lacking forms of transportation. We have a smaller van. Last year, we received $1.9 million from the federal government. This is money that will help us see the patients, the uninsured. Our operating budget was a little over $11 million. So if we relied on this $1.9 million, we would never make it, right? So we have to go out and contract with all the commercial insurance plans, all state Medicaid programs. We accept Medicare, and we provide a sliding fee to those patients that would otherwise not afford medical care. So this is my sales pitch when I have new grads, you know, new doctors coming out. For one thing is loan repayment, whether it's the federal or the state loan repayment program. If you don't want to come out to Arizona, do yourself a favor. Look up other community health centers, because if you can get on the loan repayment program, I mean, what a benefit it was for me, and it can be for you too. The other thing is you'll be working side by side with other doctors, so you'll never be alone. And you know what, when you first get out in practice, it's always good to bounce something off another doctor, even if it's just for reassurance. Just to know, you want to know you're not missing anything. Our malpractice is covered through the Federal Tort Claims Act. It's like being a military doctor. The other thing that, for me, I didn't know, but when I joined the private practice and I decided that I had made the wrong move, you know, 10 months later, I'm miserable. When I left to go practice at the community health center, well, now I have to pay a tail coverage. because in the private practice, the malpractice coverage you get covers you while you're working. But if you leave, you have to pay. And I had to come up with like $3,000 to pay that tail coverage. And that just covered me in case a lawsuit was brought up after I left, that the insurance would still cover me. But I didn't know that. So with the Federal Torts Claim Act, you wouldn't have to worry. If you came out and you realized, no, community health center is not for me, move on. And you don't have to come up with extra money to pay. The pathology you see in a community health center, it's amazing. I mean, it's great because you never know what you're gonna walk into. And you're gonna work with like-minded individuals, people that are there for the same reason. They have that same mission in mind. So 23 years later, you know, I've worked at community health centers. I worked at a total of 4 organizations. I started out as a regular doctor. Then I became a medical director, a associate medical director, a chief medical officer, and now the chief executive officer for our organization. So the opportunities that there are for you there, you don't just have to go there and be a doctor. You can start out being a doctor and then become one of our physician champions who's working on improving the asthmatic children, improving the care to our diabetic patients. If you then decide you wanted an administrative role, you may become the medical director, the chief medical officer. And if you're as fortunate as I was, then you may be the next chief executive officer for the organization, whose goal is not only to continue to provide quality medical care to all, but also to assure that the organization, the staff, is working in an environment that is caring, that is respectful, and we're there for the same reason, to provide high quality care.
ATSU is the premier provider of healers for the health center movement. We have a little over 2,000 graduates working in the health center. The premier college amongst all of those is KCOA. KCOA has produced more community health center physicians than any school in America. And as you know, we've started additional medical school, two dental schools, and are converting the PA program, all will be focused also on community health center world. And this is one of our heroes, one of the alumni all-stars. Thank you for being an alumni all-star and really living the example of what KCMO and ATSU is all about. Thank you, Dr.
Really quick. My ego isn't so big that I had this made for me. This was a gift from the staff. They gave it to me for my birthday.
Certainly appreciate you coming back on behalf of ATSU. Thank you very much. With that, we wouldn't want you to leave without a gift. So we've got that for you here. Well,
thank you very much.
Thank you.